Okay, so should we get started? I've still found no way of getting the audio on here, so I might finish a little bit early because I can't keep the audio presentation I wanted to. Obviously, a usability issue, so it's exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, so I now want to talk to you about some of the principles of use that you should be thinking about. So some of the things that you should be thinking about as we go through, or as you go through the building process. Okay, so these things aren't anything to do with principles that are that are going to come from your specific system build. They're principles that have evolved over a period of time based on best practice, really, okay, and science. But in this context, mostly best practice. The other thing is that in the other talks, you'll be seeing that there's a matrix in your notes of different kinds of principles, different things that different authors suggest as being good for usability, good for effective computing, good for gamification and phonology and that kind of thing. You don't normally get this in accessibility so much. So why do you think we get a lot of it in my pessimistic view in some way? Why do you think we get that in usability in other? Why do we get this different number of different kinds of principles we should be thinking about in other domains, like in usability or in effective use? Any ideas? So the reason is that lots of people who are usability practitioners, lots of people who are talking heads in this domain, write books. And if you're going to write a book, you want to make some money, so you write a book. And you write a different set of usability principles, which are pretty much similar to others. They're just sort of called different things. Okay? And so generally, it's about a money-making scheme, in my opinion anyway. There's lots of usability books. They give you different ideas about what you should be thinking about in usability or in effective or in gamification, but one of the main reasons they're there is because they can make a lot of money out of it. Okay? So in the others, I've put these together into kind of principles that are like umbrella principles. This, in accessibility and effective use, there's not so much noise, if you like. Pretty much everybody agrees on those principles. Okay, so if you find there's a slight difference to mine, so I'm going to tell you the ones that everybody else has than the ones that I created. Yes. But when you say, 5 to 10% of the population shouldn't bother with accessibility, Gap, for instance, when Gap was called out about their accessibility on their website, said, yeah, because we don't want to sell to blind people, we don't want to have people in our clothes. Not good marketing. American Airlines, we're not bothered about it outside of accessibility, it's a matter of blind people can't get it. That's the way it works, unfortunately. You just have to go back and look at the literature, look at the Gap case, look at the American Airlines case. There's very little money. It's becoming more, and the thing that we can also see more is that there's actually, there's a rationale for it now with mobile. In fact, mobile devices really are the enablers of accessibility. Because, in some regards, everybody that has this situation, everybody needs to be able to get information on a small screen or with limited visual or limited data, bandwidth, limited computational functionality, that kind of thing. So it's becoming more of a business case because you can get more people. also, when you think about the amount of spending, say the government did a study, and you know the amount of money that it is at the disposal that disabled users in the UK have as disposable income is huge. And it's not being tapped into. So that's one of the economic drivers that for accessibility as well. Okay. So, Potter principles of effective use. So these Potter principles are something that everybody who is in accessibility, in effective use, everybody knows. PAUL, okay? Stands for perceivable. So here, can you see it? C is in brackets, is in the quote. And by C, I mean, can you perceive it for your particular, So, is it tying to you? So that might not just be seeing, it might also be about vision, about hearing, it might also be about cognitive, it might be about literacy. Can you perceive it? Can you get that information in? Okay. That's the first thing, perceivable. Operable is the second one. Can you use it? So once you've got access to it, can you do anything useful with it then? So we've got this idea of operability in computers in general, but here we want to know, once you've got that knowledge and you've been able to get access to the knowledge or to the presentation, can you do something useful with it? Understandable. So you want to be able to do something useful with it, so how can we then understand it? And the final one is a bit of a weird one, but people still use it. Robust. Is it fault tolerant? So is your application fault tolerant? Because that's a critical driver, people say, for accessibility, because people often can't tell whether a fault has occurred, they can't even tell if a fault has occurred. If your screen reader say suddenly stops working, then you're in trouble because you don't know what's happening. So that's why it needs to be robust. Often people will say that software needs to be fault tolerant because generally if it stops, it's as bad as somebody taking the keyboard away or somebody removing the screen from you. You can't see what's going on, but you can't get information in. So that's why people nature. You'll notice that, well, what kind of examples am I using it yet? So all my examples at the moment are a lot of them about visual disability, okay? Blindness, profound blindness. There's two reasons for that. The first reason is pragmatic one, because that's my area of interest, that's my field of study. And the second one is because it's often seen as being one of the more complicated disabilities. So lots of examples are based on visual disability. Cognitive disability is very complex, and cognitive disability hasn't really been studied directly yet, certainly in the accessibility or effective use domain, because it's so variable. That's one of the other things, it's so variable to understand. Whereas, say, visual disability or deafness isn't as much. Okay, so I don't hold with these four only, okay? I hold with these. So footstool is a way of you remembering this. We'll get to that in a moment. Just bear with me. So perceivable, we've got, as per normal. Operable, yeah? Open. So why do you think open is useful? Why do you think I've just inserted open? Open is something that is a useful thing. Yes.
You can't necessarily in your design, because there's so much variety in all these aspects that you've been talking about, there's so much variety, you can't necessarily include everything, and so being able to allow other people to build solutions on top of what you've provided and to extend it to make it more accessible for other people.
Yes, that's right. we can't account for every single need, requirement. Okay, we can't understand everything. So what we do is, if we can make these things open, then we can make them extendable. We can make them extendable when we do know, when we do hit on something where there's a problem. Okay? We can create apps for that. So for instance, that's the great thing about who knows about REST? REST, okay? RESTful interfaces, okay? Well, RESTful interaction. You should think about REST. So REST on the web is an excellent thing. Twitter uses RESTful services and remote procedure calls, that kind of thing, to allow people to create their own clients, which they'll take into Twitter, say, or Facebook, say. Okay? And that means that you can create accessible Twitter clients, you can create accessible Facebook clients, if you've got an open API or some variety to interact with. Yeah? And that means that Twitter don't have to make, they make their site accessible, but they don't have to think about it any further than that, because they say, our data is open, so our APIs are open, so all you have to do is create your own client to layer on top and consume the data that's there, as long as we provide you with everything. Okay.
Don't you usually lose consistency when you make it open?
Lose consistency when you make it open? What do you mean by consistency?
Guarantee that the user has a good user experience throughout.
Okay, guarantee that the user has a good user experience. So there's two things. First of all, we can't guarantee anything. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is, a good user experience, it all depends. The openness means that you can create open APIs, which means that you don't affect Twitter, but you can layer onto it your own client, which might be necessary for somebody else, for instance. So that's why we can have, you know, people might use different kinds of Twitter clients because it's better for them. It's better for their technology. It's better for the way they work. It's better for their interactions. But they want to have lots of different, like for instance, TweetDeck. TweetDeck started off not owned by Twitter, and it was a lot better than Twitter for a lot of people because it allowed you to look at all the hashtags all in one go in multiple columns. You could get a broad overview. Well, if Twitter hadn't allowed their API to be open, then or their data to be open, then they wouldn't allow, then we wouldn't be able to do anything about it.
Yeah.
We wouldn't be able to create that API. And also note that Twitter makes its data open a lot of the time because that's why we do a lot of social network analysis. Yeah. Yes?
I was going to say, further to that, I guess, you can provide a good experience of the person, as well as the user of the program.
Yes.
About the design, about the difficulty of using it, as well as the difficulty of using it.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true. So you can make the API accessible and easy to use as well. And you can make the API accessible to coders, and that makes it easier to use. And I think that's a valid point. In fact, there's work at the Research and Development Working Group. On HTML5 and HTML5 specification, whereby the HTML5 specification is now moving to a point where it's kind of very difficult for you to just start with Notepad and build your own web page because it's quite a complicated specification. Previously, the power of the web was that anybody could create their own web page. Now it's a lot more difficult because it's gone more programmatic. And I think the same here is true that oftentimes with APIs, you can have good APIs or badly put together APIs. The normal reason why you put badly put together APIs is because they're not thought through properly. They just slap together to do a quick, dirty job. And also, they're oftentimes that they're extended bit by bit. There's no refactoring. So that can be a problem. So that's very true, yeah. Okay, understandable. Can you understand it? Flexible. So who's done their star Xerox star work? Okay, what do we know about flexible? Do you think? building flexibility in means an adaptive behaviour possibility in, or the ability for people to customise your application to a certain level, means that you can start off at a rough level of granularity and then make it progressively more refined to the user. So for instance, has anybody heard of CCPP? It's a device protocol. It's a device profile protocol, actually. And it allows you to describe your device. Okay. Now that means that different applications can change themselves, adapt themselves, based on the knowledge of what the device is and what it can accept in and what it can accept out. So it's kind of adaptive, yes.
And flexible actually means also that you achieve the same outcomes with different ways of doing things?
Yes. Absolutely, that's one of the main ways. So you can achieve the same end goal by doing it in different ways based on, well, very cognitive, based on how you want to do it as an individual, because the way that you think might be different to the way that somebody else thinks. What you think is good for you might be different to what somebody else so individual designers. But that's the problem that we're talking about with autobiographical design. Okay, so autobiographical design is about you as a developer just building something you think is good. But the way that you think might not be anything like the way that lots of people think in the world. Okay, so flexible, is it flexible? So does this mean that this means that it can be adapted? So has anybody got any experience with adaptive systems? Adaptive web systems, hypermedia systems? No? Okay, so have a look at adaptive systems, and they adapt based on how many times you've used that service. How many times have you used the system? Are you moving from being a novice user to an expert user? Okay. Those kind of things. Can you move quickly? One of the big problems, one of the old big problems for the Mac operating system was there was no shortcuts. So it was super easy to start to use the Mac operating system, easier than all the rest, when you just pointing and clicking. But when you became more than a novice user to an expert user, it became far more difficult to use because, well, not more difficult, just slower. Because you were annoyed that you couldn't use hotkeys, you couldn't do things quickly. Shortcut keys. Okay, so, poof. Anybody got a granny who's got one of these? A poof? A footstool? Okay, so that's how you should remember it, okay? If you want to remember this for your exam, it's perceivable, operable, open, understandable, and flexible, and it's the thing that you put your feet on at your granny's house. Mm-hmm. Yeah? When you're being fed cake and tea on a Sunday afternoon. Yes, okay? That's what it is. So remember that way. Okay, so we want to understand how we can do these things. How can we facilitate these particular things when we're going through our building? So we've got the first one here to start us off. Questions to think about. Does your system contain information by colour alone, but without an alternate text description? So sometimes, what this means is sometimes you'll have a box that comes on the screen and it's in green and says, it's in green, that's it, it's just in green. Yeah, it's great. Traffic lights. We have, in this university, a system called EPROG, which is about, which is a system for PhD students to register, you know, what they're doing, where they're up to, their milestones and their reports. And it has a traffic light system. Red, green, blue. Red if there's a problem, and if they've not completed stuff on time, green if everything's good. But the problem with that is that if you're blind, or you're colourblind, tricolouring or dichroic, then it's green. Yeah. You can't see whether somebody is out of date or not. There's no other way of knowing, it just goes red. There's no date. Okay, so that's a problem, and it's human, you know, it happens everywhere. So let's think of some more then. Facilitate perceivability. What kind of things do we think we need to do do you think you need to think about? What questions do you need to think about when you want to facilitate this? Any ideas? No idea. Is there a name and label for each thing? The reason why we have names and labels is because we make an association between the two. So for instance, on a form, if you don't have a label that's associated with that form box interface component, oftentimes, then there's going to be a problem. Because the label just sits there, maybe not filled out with any useful information, and there's a problem with the actual text, with the actual label itself. If you do this cool thing that people have now, where you've got a form component that's pre-filled in with a name, like the label already in the form component, then that's very confusing for a lot of people. People with cognitive disabilities, also people with visual disabilities. So there's no understanding that actually means it's a label of something. Okay? Include alternatives for icons. If the icon is meant to convey something, include some alternative description so it can be perceived. If it's just an icon and it can't be perceived by someone who's visually disabled, then what's its purpose for everybody else? Try and understand what is the purpose of this for everybody else, and should we then be able to describe it in some way? Okay. So that's the main thing. And this is really just things like, are your alt tags worked out, filled out? Simple stuff. Very simple stuff. Any more? Any more about the scene? No? Can we use a personalised interface settings so that those settings can be more perceivable? Okay. In the new user agent working group guidelines, user agent accessibility guidelines, then there's the idea of creating a list of important elements on a page that a user can create. So therefore the user can see a page based on the elements that they think are important, not the ones that they think are superfluous. So then, therefore, you can look at that order, yes?
Size that you can make the text.
We already know that, only 95% of blind people can actually see something. You need a screen magnifier, because, we've got 10-15% profoundly blind, but apart from that, that's, most blind users can see something, even down to colours. So therefore, having this kind of idea whereby with colours, the alternate, the antidote, if you like, to number one on here, or the first qualities, if you've got some limited vision, then you want text, you want some textual confirmation that's not based on colour for people with colour blindness or profound blindness, but you might want a very strong colour to indicate that people who can't really perceive the text but will be able to perceive the colour. Okay. Text sizes, typography. What do we know about typography and serifs and sans serifs?
Serifs are better.
Serifs can be better for reading. Sans serifs people seem to like sans serifs for the way that they look. But if you're actually doing a real reading task, then serifs are better for your cicades. Yeah?
Is there a difference between them depending on
your
blind? Is one of them
if it's blurred, it gives you more to understand what's going on, even more than what that puts you. Okay. How easy is it to find and interact with interface controls and shortcuts to them? Okay. So, how easy to find and interact with these controls? Now, you can do it by pointing, but what happens if there's no, try it. Go onto one of your systems and then just say, right, take a mouse out. How do I move between interface components? Are those interface components labelled such that I can perceive them? So if you've got a group in, say, a tab, is that group labelled? Or multiple groups in a tab, or in the dialogue, are those groups labelled to give people an idea about what those things, what those radio buttons or those selectors or controls are about in context? Or do you just, or not? Is it just easy for somebody who's sighted to see and to understand the context from, or is it difficult for somebody else who doesn't have that context? What we've also got to remember with this is that for a lot of users, sighted users certainly, you've got a thing called external memory. So the actual screen itself is an external memory. If you can't think of what it is, then you can just glance back at the screen to understand the context. But if you're listening to this in an audio stream, you don't get that. You have to remember it and then remember the context. There's no looking back without reading the whole thing out again. Yeah? So that's a lot. It's been shown on most web pages, just as a web page thing, on most web pages, sighted users can get a general overview of the web page in about 5 seconds. For visually disabled users, even at the fastest reading speeds, they can get an overview of the page in about 2.5 minutes. That's an audio glance. So there's a lot of time there wasted. And that's what we're also trying to think about. Yes?
Is that
a
reason for reducing clutter
and stuff? Yeah. It's a reason for reducing, also clutter myself, most people say. We've done a number of surveys, a number of work, quite a lot of work on the visual and aesthetics and visual complexity. And yeah, most people like a decluttered, clean and clear interface, and they like one that's got lots of stuff. That's all right. Okay. Have you provided keyboard focus? Text cursors. Will your system restore its previous state when regaining focus? If you bomb out, can you get back to that previous state? If it's in the grid, it ought to be in. Does. Are you saving state as you move forward? Okay, so let's look at openness. Question about, if you have provided specific meaningful names and labels for each interface component, including alternatives for icons and the like, are these names displayed and available to third-party technology? So is the meaning, the semantics, available to other systems that don't know about your system? Okay. Anything else about openness? Open APIs, I mean, you're also going to be in those research, you don't make some leaps of original thought for 25%. No? Yes?
It's like, it depends on what you're.
For now, I'm not going to be asking you to remember all of these questions that you should be answering. You might be asked to remember the kind of principles, but you shouldn't necessarily be remembering all of these things. These are exemplars. I'd expect you guys to be able to think, that's what I also need to think about, that's what I need to think about. Okay? These are questions. So that's, you should, anybody here, I don't care whether you get the next question right, because there's no right directly, but are you thinking about how we can make things open? Very good. Have you provided documentation? Okay. So are your APIs, are your RESTful interfaces, is everything documented so that you can understand what's required? Okay. That's critical. Okay, so I've got things like, is the software open such that information is available to third-party systems, including conventional assistive technology? Or things like, does the software allow inputs and manipulation by these third-party software? So can you manipulate? It might be just, like with Twitter, there's not that much manipulation. You're creating a new tweet and that's it, but you're not doing any real or any other manipulation. It's just you're just consuming the data. Fair enough, they think that's a security issue possibly. But you need to think about that too. If your system is closed, then just allow all inputs and outputs to pass through a third-party software. So even if it's closed, is there some way that you can allow your system to do some other kind of software, as using a plugin architecture or some other kind, something like that, so that you can actually redevelop or redesign the presentation there? So who knows about Model View Controller? Good, so Model View Controller also separates these concerns. So what you ought to think about is how can I make this view layer far more flexible so that you can have any different model or controller in there. Yeah? Okay. Operability, first one. Can we control all aspects of an audiovisual presentation such as video? Why might this be? Certain hearing impairments, you might not be able to hear certain frequencies, which means that you might need to change the frequency boundary of audio. Okay? You might have a different pitch. You might want to be able to pause the audio, which will automatically pause the video when you see it, because you're still trying to read it, or sorry, to understand it. You might want to create subtitles on the fly. Any more? This operability. And then we've all had enough. 1 hour and 40 minutes of pain and anger. We're not having it yet. So we'll answer some damn questions, for God's sake. I'm staying here, even though I've got a curry at 12 o'clock. I'm staying here and doing a more question answer. No shirking. Okay. Can they use a personalised interaction settings and change the length of any timed event, for instance? Any more? Not going. I'm looking at doors. No, you've done too many. You've too many. You've got a chat box of the group. Some of the silent types of normal kitchen parties. Come on, say something. The actions are allowed to scale. Come back to you, so we better start thinking. Come on, any more? Are all functions, interface components, interactions available to be controlled via the keyboard? Everything must be controllable via the keyboard. It's the most primary form of interactive control, okay? Of input control. So even the pointer needs to be able to be controllable, or the way of moving focus of these needs to be controllable. Yeah?
What about people over time use keyboards?
Well, that's okay, because if you can't use keyboard, everything can, because it's the most, if you like, most basic piece of equipment, everything can actually plug into the keyboard. So generally, say, so converter switches, keyboard, raising parameter switches, keyboard, they all set out keyboard, equivalent to the keyboard interface. So that's the most basic thing. Everything, every piece of technology allows itself to plug into keyboard, even soft keyboard, and are all functions, interface components, interactions able to be controlled via a mouse-like control pointer? Okay, that's the next level up. So as well as being controlled by a keyboard, you must also be able to make sure that they're controllable by some kind of pointing device. Okay, as well. So if you can't use the keyboard, because you don't have the dexterity, but you might be able to use a joystick. Any more? Are all multiple corded key presses available in sticky sequential format? What the hell does that mean? So you want stickies, and people who can't press stickies at the time, you might not have, you might only have one or. If you're making those keys far apart, then you're not going to be able to do that. It might be that you've got dexterity problems, you've got tremors, okay, which means that you're going to press a key. Same with auto repeat. How can we change auto repeat as well? Because you might be pressing something multiple times when you need one press. Okay. state, can you get back to the same state? Okay, understandability, two more to go, come on. RSync meaningful name and label for each interface component. You've seen this before. It's the same for understandability. It's a 2-for-1 deal. Yes?
So,
yes, keeping any language you simple is a big help, that's true. And also, if you don't want to keep the language simple, some way to make it simple so that you can actually have different levels. Different, you know, you can have these as language packs, I suggest, different kinds of language packs. We also have seen, you see the, this is an amusing one, you've seen some gamification, but it sort of plays on this with the language idea. Have you seen the copy cache machine? Yeah, copy cash machines. Have you seen the copy cash machines? So if you go down, they've got these in London, obviously, it's a way of getting you to go to their cash points. But all of the language, they have a Cockney language pack. Okay, so you know, you'll see the different. I have no, I can't remember what the hell they say now. But generally, you know, all of the transactions are in Cockney, rhyming slang. Okay, so that's not a traditional language. It's just something they've done for phonology. But it doesn't mean to say that that's not something that we shouldn't think about when it comes to language simplification. Can you get different levels of language simplification? Could you actually have different language packs, different grades of languages? Okay. Are all interface control interaction features well documented? That's the documentation issue again. Understandability. Error or alert messages give consistent information. So a lot of times you might get inconsistent information because they look slightly different, and also you get the ones whereby they're errors that computer geeks understand. You know, error 1406, you know, looking random, kind of really helpful. Okay. In fact, some people would say that systems should never put up, there should never be a time when you need to display an error. You should gracefully grade from that error message. You should, you know, that if you're allowing user input to error, there's something going wrong with your code base. Okay. So, do you follow the OS keyboard conventions and best practice and style guidelines? It could be argued, and I do argue this, but it could be argued that sort of interface development, unless you're one of the big companies, done. Widget developments, these GUI frameworks that you're using, you've got to use the same look and feel as people expect to see on their phone. How would you like to have an interface for an iPad application that looks nothing like what an iPad application should look like? Because you've decided to use your own interface. Okay. That's not going to be helpful because it doesn't tie into the cognitive understanding of users. And it's the same in this context for accessibility. You want things to be consistent and as expected. Yeah. Have you tied the system into the system-wide spell check? Maybe that's just a little thought. Seems stupid, seems strange. People might not, but I've seen systems where you don't get any spell checking because they've not tied it into the system-wide spell check, and that's a problem for understandability, it can be. Okay, flexibility, finally. Does system allow users to conform the colour encoding of their preferences? So for instance, if we're going to have, say for instance, we're going to put error messages in red, if you're dichromic, trichromic, you might not be able to see red. Can you change it to a different colour that you can see? Or you can see flexibility. Can use a personalised interaction settings, change the length of timed events so that an event that's timed lasts longer, which you need more time to read it. Can use a personalised interface settings again, another 2-for-1. We've already seen this before. And can the keyboard be remapped? So why want to remap the keyboard? Because if we've only got limited dexterity and we want to have we've got a modifier key, as we were talking about in the back, if you don't have sticky keys, we've got a modifier key, then we put keys that we use a lot together in one place so that they're easier, because we've got dexterity problems very easy to hit. For instance. Do you like keyboard shortcuts, accelerator keys? Okay, so we're nearly there. So the question is, from this, you should be thinking about these kind of questions that you might not have, these kind of things that you might not have thought about directly before, and their importance. Okay? You should be able to understand their importance for the mainstream, if you like, and understand how to think or have some thoughts about the kind of questions that you need to be asking when you're building interfaces. Building apps. Now, for next week, pop quiz, it's in your notes, give an example of accessibility, of why accessibility is for everybody. What's your view? Ha-ha! I will absolutely, 100% be asking you this question. What's your view of commons or impairment? You see, my view is in the notes. What's your view? If it doesn't agree with me, okay, verbal punching. Okay, so we shall see. Pick an interface bridge and describe it. What is the relationship between effective and accessible design? Okay. What are the five main principles of effective design? Now, and obviously the corona is by flexible. Who's read any more of Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? I'm going to keep asking this until you give in. So, read the damn thing. Alright, so next week, pop quiz, discuss the questions, read up to the end of these notes. If you've got any questions, come see me on Friday or now. I'll see you next week. Remember, you've got a four work section next week, after from 11 till 12, which will be in here as well. The other thing to consider is your the Turing lecture next Wednesday night. If you want to go to it, you need to register. It's on the website. Places are limited. It's at 5:30. But it should be interesting. Alright, see you next week.